We often assume that losing the ability to walk is the biggest problem of a person who is wheelchair-bound. However, have you ever thought about the other invisible complications? How they might impact someone's life and how these invisible complications may be even more important than the ones we can see. In this video, I'll tell you more about paraplegia, which is a spinal cord injury. You will learn about the two types that can be distinguished, complete and incomplete paraplegia. Moreover, the causes of spinal cord injury and its complications will be covered. Lastly, we will look at the treatment options and the impact that a spinal cord injury has on daily life activities. By the end of this video, you are able to explain what the condition of paraplegia is, and you will have a better grasp of what it's like to live with the condition. So what is paraplegia? Paraplegia is a form of paralysis with seriously impaired function from the waist downwards. It's almost always caused by damage to the brain or a spinal cord injury, or in some cases, even both. Most often, spinal cord injuries to the thoracic, lumbar, or pelvic spinal cord areas are to blame. These injuries prevent signals to travel from and towards the lower part of the body, thus resulting in both motor and sensory loss of function. This means that paraplegics not only struggle with the loss of movement below the waist, but also with serious impairments of sensory sensations. Depending on the height of the injury, also the arms or even the breathing muscles may be paralyzed. This can have a huge impact on someone's daily life functioning. If we go into a bit more detail, you will find that there are two main categories of spinal cord injuries, namely complete and incomplete. These terms refer to the level of sensation and movement that a person still experiences after their injury. People with a complete spinal cord injury cannot move or feel anything below the region where the trauma occurred. However, when the person still does retain some functionality in the lower body, we call this an incomplete spinal cord injury. There are various gradings of incomplete injuries, and functions may be retained more on one side of the body than the other. Which criterion do you think is used to distinguish between the two types? You may be surprised to learn that the criterion used is the level of sensation in the anus. If nothing can be felt and there's no ability to contract the anus, someone is thought to have complete paraplegia. The exact diagnosis includes an indication of the height of the injury, indicated by a vertebral number, as you can see in the image here. This height is determined by analyzing where the lowest part of the spinal cord is that still has intact nerve roots. For example, in someone with T12 paraplegia, the nerve roots that appear below the 12th thoracic vertebrae are still intact. Now that you know what paraplegia broadly means and how we indicate the severity, you may be wondering what exactly causes this condition. Again, we can divide the causes in two main groups. The cause can be either traumatic or can be non-traumatic. Here, traumatic means that the injury was caused by an external factor. And those are the most important causes, with among them traffic accidents, for example, accounting for about 35% of the cases. Other causes of traumatic paraplegia include self-harm or violence, sport accidents, and industrial accidents. Non-traumatic paraplegia points to an internal cause and can arise as a result of either a virus or a bacterial infection, tumors pressing on the spinal cord, blood supply disorders, or in rare cases due to a birth defect. The disruption of signal transmission to some parts of the body has immediate consequences. Most people with paraplegia have completely paralyzed legs, and as the height of the injury increases, the torso may also be affected. If this is the case, someone may experience difficulty with sitting upright and maintaining balance. Consequently, daily activities that require the use of arms, such as dressing, doing the laundry, or simply eating, may cost a lot of effort. Furthermore, due to the spinal cord injury, feelings on the skin surface are no longer perceived. And the tricky part of this is that paraplegics don't feel any pain when, for example, they bump into something, get stuck somewhere, or maybe burn themselves. Common reported examples are of people that burn their feet to the car heating, or the rise of blisters from shoes that fit too tight. They will only notice so until they actually see what has happened. And could be even worse than that, like breaking a bone. Now, the takeaway here is that people with spinal cord injuries miss their natural warning mechanisms for physical discomfort. And this can result in unfortunate situations. Besides these two main and most direct complications, often also loss of function of organ control arises, resulting in many other health issues, often going unnoticed by outsiders. Here is a list summing the various health aspects that paraplegia has an influence on. You can find out more about these complications in the assigned readings for this week. In addition to health issues listed here, paraplegia can also have some more specific medical consequences, as listed here on the right. Many patients will at some point be confronted with these consequences, and they will need additional medical treatment. Paraplegia is a very serious injury, with many visible and invisible health implications. Yet, there's still no cure. And this makes rehabilitation treatment even more critical. Right after hospital discharge, most people with a recent spinal cord injury are admitted to specialized clinics. These offer extensive rehabilitation programs that are customized to the individual needs of each patient. The main goal is that someone learns to make the best use of his possibilities, so that they can continue daily life as independently as possible. These programs are very patient-centered, with attention for personal wishes and needs. Usually, a clinical admission takes a few months, and after this, a new phase starts, the aftercare. People often have to return to the clinic one or multiple times per week to receive further therapies or coaching. Because paraplegia is chronic, and since it knows so many secondary disorders, people will continue to have regular medical checkups. This phase is also known as cure and care, and remains important throughout the further life. The rehabilitation programs and therapies prepare patients to resume their daily life. Often, this goes hand in hand with necessary adjustments. Just think about your own living situation. Would your home meet the new circumstances? Are your doors broad enough to fit a wheelchair? And where's your bedroom? Is it on the second floor? And your car, are you still able to use it? These are all just practical questions, but another one would be whether it's even possible to arrange the care you need in your specific neighborhood. Those are all challenges that disabled people will have to face upon their clinical discharge. And initially, this may be very hard. However, most people have reported to find and learn a new adjusted routine. Ordinary things such as going to work, doing the laundry, driving, and even cycling are all activities that paraplegics are able to do with some practice. And it doesn't stop there. Over the past years, competitive and recreational sporting opportunities have increased tremendously, with more and more customized sport equipment reaching the market. Name any sport, and it's almost guaranteed that there has been some kind of spin-off that made it possible to practice for people with a disability. Now we've come to the end of this video about paraplegia and its complications. In the next video, we'll explore more about how exoskeletons can aid in the rehabilitation process of paraplegics. Also, we'll talk about the advantages of exoskeleton technology for people with a spinal cord injury.